That is, except for the Owlbot, who is just waking up. Its CRT-based head illuminates its surroundings and is capable of rotating 360 degrees in order to spot battery bugs.
Hello, Louis here. We have just updated my robotic planet course for Blender with a new chapter featuring the solitary Owlbot. Fair warning, this video does sometimes contain references to part of the larger course available at cgboost.com. But if you just want to get an overview of how the robot is made and perhaps inspire your own robotic creations, then this is the video for you. This character is the marriage of an owl and an old-school CRT television, based mainly on the comparable proportion of an owl's head and an old TV set, in my mind at least. And I thought it would be fun to have its eyes project light out into the surrounding environment. The concept is boxy, like the previous designs, however the art style still has some curvature to consider. My idea was to have each robot animation string together with a David Attenborough-style voiceover. I found the process of writing the accompanying script quite helpful in contributing to the world-building, adding a bit more legitimacy to the design choices. This was sketched up in Procreate, but could easily be sketched in Blender or Krita. Modelling. Although not exactly an accurate model of an owl or a TV, come to that, I still found it useful to capture some references in PureRef in order to pick up on any details and remind me the overall proportions of an owl or a TV. Handy as well if you're not starting from a concept sketch. Proportions were balanced first by blocking out the forms without committing too much to the geometry, checking silhouettes using the flat shading method or tweaking the viewport focal length to mirror the type of lens an owl would be captured with, i.e. something like a long telephoto lens. With the shape blocking out done, it was time to build the more refined shapes. The first phase involved using primitives subdivided with creases along the edges. This keeps the geometry low and enables subtle curves. Boolean slices were then used to create angular cuts. These Boolean operations can, and most often will, result in mesh artifacts. And there are two approaches that I usually like to take at this point. Either make the cut work, keeping like a nice grid of quads by adding edges and sliding vertices, or applying the sub-D modifier, then Boolean, and then re-meshing. If you have difficulty with Booleans, then we have a whole host of tips in our troubleshooting video here on YouTube. Now, deformation wasn't really a priority as the owl parts are rigid, so as long as it looks okay, polyflow isn't paramount. So I lent on an auto-retopology tool, namely Quad Remesher. This is a paid add-on, well worth it in my opinion, however there is an option in Blender called Quadraflow that can get pretty good results. Alternatively, the remesh modifier on Sharp can give some quite nice results as well, again good for non-deforming surfaces. If, however, you do want to dive into more refined retopology, you might want to check out Zach's video, link in the description. Now we can reapply our sub-D modifier, add creases and a bevel modifier for our final shape. Other parts were modelled from primitives and, if featuring curved geometry, subdivided with creases and then edge bevels. It's cursory to the owl model, but the tree branches were built with the skin modifier, subdivision and decimate modifiers. Let's move on to materials. The majority of materials were brought in from an asset library we made in Chapter 4 of the course, dragging and dropping plastic, metal and the like, and customizing the color. However, there are some notable exceptions. The background, which was driven by an animated Musgrave texture, which has since been replaced by the Noise Texture node in Blender 4.1. The shader-based CRT owl face uses spherical gradient along with greater than math nodes to create the eyes, and then a linear gradient with compare math nodes that has the vector coordinates altered slightly with another gradient to create the beak and brow effect. And at the end of the chain, a scanline effect using a heavily scaled Voronoi texture. There's also some nice blur, brightness, and transitional driver controls hooked up to a custom bone property. I go over these in way more detail in the course, but hopefully that gives you a quick overview. On to rigging. This rig takes what we already learned in the Basic Bot chapter of the course and adds some driver and constraint-driven mechanics. Firstly, any mesh booleans and other heavy computational modifiers were applied. And then bones were introduced where we want the individual parts to pivot. The character was rigged for the shot, so rigging intricate details in the feathers and the like weren't really necessary. After adding the deformed bones, creating a hierarchy and parenting the objects to said bones, it was time to think about the best control to have over the owlbot for animation. Enter constraints and the control rig. The head needed to move up and down within its socket and also be able to spin freely. I chose to have two bones to control this, one exclusively for spinning the upper portion of the head, and the other for the whole head and neck system, including a little hinged element at the bottom here for a little bit more complexity. This was enabled with a damp track and a limit rotation constraint, so the bone couldn't break out of its housing. The head bone also has a constraint that copies the local rotation of the body bone, with a reduced influence to create this kind of nice soft follow effect. From head down to tail. Now this one is pretty simple and is a damp track targeting another bone, so it's a little bit easier to affect the rotation channels just by grabbing that one target controller and moving it around. The constraints here are mainly about limiting movement on different axes, which can be done quite quickly from locking the channels in the item options, but I generally prefer to do it in the bone constraints, as it's easier to copy from one bone to the other. I as well find it handy to compartmentalize the constraints into one section of Blender's interface. I rarely use the limit distance constraint, but it's great for situations like this, the owlbot's telescopic legs with inset tubes. This is similar to setting up generic hydraulic rigs. So we have our child of the leg system here pointing with a damp track to our leg offset R, and in turn that points back to the parent of our leg here. So when we grab things, it sort of moves in and out like so. However, the complication lies with this middle section, which with the aid of a limit distance, we can create the effect of grabbing the bone, having nothing happen until we reach a certain distance, and then the system or the segments start to collapse down. And this is because the constraint is basically looking for our foot offset R and trying to keep it at this distance away from it. So outside of this distance, it does nothing. And inside of this distance, it tries to move the bone away. And I've just reduced the influence down a little bit, so it feels like a nice soft collapse when all of these segments come together. But don't worry if this is looking a bit complicated, as we'll look at setting up this exact rig within chapter 12 of the course. Each foot has an additional bone controller that is the parent of each toe section, in every way but scale, which is set to none in the bone properties. So now scaling the foot controller does nothing to the scale of the child bones, and those channels are effectively free to drive something else, namely the rotation of the toes. We can do this by using drivers and a little bit of math in a scripted expression. And this helps us use one controller instead of two, which keeps our rig nice and clean. We'll look at this rig in more detail in upcoming course videos, as well as other ways to optimize our rig so we're not overladen with thousands of controllers. The bots, for the most part, exist in isolation, with only a few environmental details to ground them. However, owlbot's scene is at night, so the HDRI image that has been used in previous scenes has a strong blue tint mixed in with a color blend mode. The HDRI light is rotated to ensure that there is a nice rim or catchlight on the owl, separating it from the background ever so slightly. And accentuating that effect is our first rim light, which we can see here, which is a large, cool area light. Just adds that little bit of extra backlight. And in the same way, we have a bottom light here, which just highlights the feet and again gives the branch a bit more definition. And then up to the main key light, which is a warmer light and acts as an almost studio light, so a large soft light source that also happens to catch nicely on the shiny elements here. And the final light is a spotlight, which mimics the effect of the light being emitted from the CRT screen. Now this light might not be necessary in cycles, as the emission shader actually emits light onto surrounding elements, but in Eevee it doesn't do that, at least not yet. Tree branches were also created in order for the owl to have something to perch on, and to have some added visual elements to add a bit of interest and frame the character. The style of these branches aligns aesthetically to the previous environment parts, being mainly faceted low poly without too much distracting texture. We'll look into how to create these as well. My preferred method of animation with these characters that don't strike any particularly extreme poses is to take a layered approach, animating the body first, which already feels quite dynamic due to the constraint setup, and then down the bone hierarchy, as either secondary inertial animation or animation with a little bit more intent, like lifting the legs to settle on the branch. I have animated a few birds in the past, so I didn't use any video references this time, but I find having actions take place over sometimes only a very few frames a good way to increase the appeal and bird-like jitteriness. I particularly like the action that birds tend to take, where, like other animals, they start shaking from the top of their head and that journeys all the way down to their tail. Another little technique I like to use is a slight drop in the body when the head turns. This is to add that little extra anticipation, and I feel gives more weight to the head as the body attempts to retain the balance with some compensation. Real-time compositing is now a thing, and the usable nodes in Blender 4.0 have been greatly improved, so a lot of the post-production can be seen in real time. In this scene, there is a vignette created with a blurred ellipse multiplied on top of our render, some film grain using a cloud texture created with the texture properties tab, and a very small scale with animated offset based on the frame number, a little softening, lens distortion, sharpening, and a little bit of color grade, using the RGB curves to increase the overall contrast, as well as tweaking the red and blue channels to give a slightly warmer image. Jumping into the render properties, along with the camera focal length to mimic how a documentary film would be shot from afar, I've switched on depth of field for a bit more background separation, as well as the jitter camera option that samples slightly different camera positions in order to make a more accurate edge defocus. This can result in some grainy smaller details of high contrast like the highlights here, so to combat that, we might need to crank up the render samples. In order to appreciate the quick movement of this character, I've also switched on motion blur with 3 steps to ensure that the rotational motion also has enough samples to look good. So that's Albot, one of 3 robots covered in quite a lot of detail on my Robotic Planet course on cgboost.com. If you want to create little robots like these, then jump on over to a link in the description. We get into the nitty-gritty with hard surfacing, procedural textures, custom rigs, animation techniques, and a whole lot more. I hope to see you there.